Good evening, everyone. A great privilege to be here yet again. I'm looking forward to tonight's presentation, How to Face Death Unafraid and with Absolute Confidence. And of course, death is something that we've all thought about. Some of us are a little older and thinking about it more than perhaps the younger class. But the reality is that this is a question that everybody wonders about. No one is immune from thinking about this question of death. Most people would probably face death with fear, with trepidation, with confusion, with concern. And our message tonight is entitled, How to Face Death Unafraid and with Absolute Confidence. And so what are we going to do first, everyone? Prayer. That's right, we're going to pray. So let's begin with a word of prayer together. Father in heaven, we come to you this evening, believing that your word holds the key, holds the answer to this question of death. And Father, we think about our Savior Jesus, who faced death. The Bible says he tasted death for every man. But the great good news of the gospel is that even though Jesus died and was buried, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. So Father, today as we study this question of how to face death unafraid, may our faith, our confidence not be in self. May our confidence not be in us, for Father, every one of us will face this great eventuality. May our confidence be in Him alone who has conquered death. That is Jesus. Be with us now as we open your word. May you open our hearts, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Let everyone say, Amen. All right, let's go directly to our study guide, How to Face Death Unafraid and with Absolute Confidence. Let's go right to our study guide, and we'll commence by reading the opening paragraph there. It says, The question of death and what happens when one dies is a question that has intrigued mankind since the very dawn of time. Even today, with significant advances in technology, medicine, and science, the question of the mystery of death remains entirely unanswered. Truth be told, science is ill-equipped to deal adequately with the issue of death. Death is more than the cessation of physiological functions and activities. It has mental, emotional, and certainly spiritual ramifications as well, both for the dying and for those who remain. The Bible, the Holy Scriptures, contains the keys that unlock this mystery of death. The Bible can provide the kinds of answers that humanity is seeking concerning this question of death. The Bible alone can illumine death's dark door. I suppose it was a couple months ago, I was looking through a magazine that I had received. It was on the extremes in nature. It was entitled something like Time's Extreme Nature Special or something like that. And very interesting in there was this quotation from a TV cameraman who was caught in the Mount St. Helens eruption. And these were, he thought, his very last words. Notice this, Mount St. Helens eruption, D. Crockett, a TV cameraman. He says, I will try the radio. Mayday, mayday, ash is coming down on me heavily. It's either dark or I am dead. God, I want to live. You know, we're all like that, aren't we? We think that we would face death with such courage, with such confidence, but the reality is that for the vast majority of people, when we are knocking right at death's door, we can have a tendency to be cowardly and to wonder in confusion, is this the end? And if it is the end, am I ready? You sense that here in this quotation. He says, I'm either alive or it's dark. God, I want to live. Now notice there on your study guide it says, according to the Bible, death is not the end. Can you say amen to that? Amen. According to the Bible, death is not the end. It is not the terminal stop on this journey of life. There is more beyond death's door. The next chapter following the death event is what the Bible calls the resurrection. That's what you'd write in there on that line. The next event after the death event is what the Bible calls the resurrection. In fact, as we will learn in a future lesson, there are actually two resurrections. Two resurrections. Now, we have been studying and spending quite a bit of time in the book of Revelation, and no other book in the entire Bible gives us a broader, more powerful, more amazing picture of the resurrected Christ than the book of Revelation. And of course, that would be expected. Revelation chapter 1, chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 7, chapter 14, chapter 19, all have pictures of the post-resurrection Jesus. Now, there's good reason for this, and I want to turn your attention here to Revelation chapter 1 and verse 18. Jesus said these words to John there as he appeared to him on the island of Patmos. He said, I am he who what? Lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And notice what he says next. Absolutely awesome. Jesus says, and I have the keys of Hades and of death. The word Hades is the Greek word. It means the grave. He says, I have the keys of the grave and of death. Jesus appears to John. He says, I am him who am alive, but I was dead, and now I will be alive forevermore. The book of Revelation shows Jesus and his post-resurrection appearances all throughout the whole book. The resurrected Christ, the resurrected Christ, the resurrected Christ. Absolutely, totally powerful. Now notice here on the screen, the resurrected Christ is the foundation of the Christian faith. That's right there in your study guide. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the foundation and the cornerstone of the Christian faith. Notice this, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the foundation and cornerstone of the Christian faith, and without the resurrection, we have no hope. I'm opening my Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, where the Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Corinth, says this very thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, you can say amen when you get there. I'm in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I'm going to pick it up in verse 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 12. We'll read several passages here, several verses here, kind of climaxing in verse 20. I'm in verse 12. The Apostle Paul says, now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection from the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. You see the logic here, very logical, very linear. Verse 14. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. King James says vain. Verse 15. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And notice verses 17 to 19. He says, and if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. I want you to think about that for just a moment. Paul says, if Jesus is not raised from the dead, your confidence in Christ, your faith in Christ as the one who has overcome death is absolutely, totally futile, which means vain and silly. Verse 18, then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. Now I want you to do something here for me. Notice it says there in verse 18, those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. I want you to take that phrase there, fallen asleep in Christ. I want you to take that idea and hang it on a hook in your mind because we're going to come back to it. Look at verse 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. It is not difficult to follow Paul's line of reasoning here. What he basically says is, the Christian person has put their confidence in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. If Jesus is not raised, if Jesus is not resurrected, what he's saying is, our confidence in the resurrection of Jesus is foolish, silly, and futile. Apparently, there were some in Corinth who were denying the resurrection of the dead. And Paul says, listen, of course there is a resurrection. Christ himself was raised from the dead. And look at verse 20. Here the Apostle Paul affirms this in the most powerful, unequivocal language. Verse 20. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. There it is again. Remember, that's that phrase I told you to hang on a hook in your mind. Fallen asleep. Fallen asleep. Two times he says it. We're actually going to look at it a little bit later into our presentation. It's not difficult to follow Paul's line of reasoning. It's not difficult to sort of say, yeah, that makes sense. I see where he's headed with this. The Christian faith is rooted and grounded and founded on this great fact, historical fact, of the death of Jesus, the burial of Jesus, and what, everyone? That's right, the resurrection of Jesus. And Paul says, and it just makes good common sense, if Jesus is not raised, then your faith in Christianity, your faith in Jesus is totally, completely futile. And that's why we say here, without the resurrection, we have how much hope? No hope. And so you're back there in your study guide. Very, very simple. Notice here the underlined portion. It says, the future resurrection of Christ's followers is founded upon the historical fact of Jesus' own resurrection. In other words, the reason that we can have confidence in our own resurrection is that we have confidence in the historical resurrection of Jesus. G.B. Hardy, in his marvelous book, Countdown, put it this way. He said, there are only two essential requirements. Two essential requirements. How many essential requirements, everyone? Two. That's exactly right. There are only two essential requirements. Number one, has anyone ever cheated death? And number two, is it available to me? Mr. Hardy goes on to say, let us survey the historical record. He says, Confucius tomb, occupied. Buddha's tomb, occupied. Muhammad's tomb, occupied. Jesus' tomb, amen, empty. That's exactly right. Hardy goes on to say, argue as you will, but for me and my purposes, there is no point in following a loser. Now, when Mr. Hardy here uses the phrase following a loser, he's not using that phrase in the sort of nanny-nanny boo-boo pejorative sense. He's not saying, you know, my dad can beat up your dad kind of a thing. What he's saying is that everyone will have to face this great eventuality called death. Buddha faced it and lost the battle. Confucius faced it and lost the battle. Muhammad faced it and lost the battle. But Jesus faced it and he was victorious. He won the battle with death. And as Mr. Hardy says, very simply, very powerfully, very logically, there are only two essential requirements. Has anyone ever cheated death? The answer to that is yes, the man Christ Jesus. And the second was, is it available to me? And Jesus said in John chapter 3 and verse 16 when speaking to Nicodemus, for God so loved the world, Nicodemus, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not what? Perish, but have, what would be the opposite of perishing? Everlasting life. Yes, someone has cheated death, number one, and yes, it is available to you by faith if you put your confidence, your belief, and your trust in the man Christ Jesus. Let's go back to our study guide here. We're actually on page 2 and we're making excellent time, for which we praise the Lord. Now notice here on the screen, we're going to ask a question. It's the same question that's there in your study guide, and it is a question that unfortunately many people have not reflected adequately upon. It says, is the soul immortal or is there a resurrection? These two things are mutually exclusive. They're, what did I say, everyone? Mutually exclusive. It's an either-or situation, not a both-and. You can't say, oh yes, the soul is immortal and there's a resurrection. It doesn't make any sense. We'll talk about that in a little bit. It's either that the soul is immortal, that is, non-dying, unending, or there's a resurrection. Either this or that. Now notice there in your study guide it says, this is a very important question, one that most Christians have not reflected upon adequately, even non-Christians. Consider, for example, the case of Mary. Mary, the mother of Jesus, has been making frequent appearances here on planet Earth to encourage, inspire, and warn believers of a coming calamity. These appearances, or sometimes called apparitions, are occurring with increasing frequency. Millions of people claim to have seen Mary at locations all over the globe, both urban locations, rural locations, Western nations, Eastern nations, so-called third world countries, and so-called first world countries. Millions of people claim to have seen this Mary. Bleeding statues, weeping statues, visions in the sun and clouds, and physical appearances are all cited as mounting evidences that Mary has returned with an important message. This phenomenon has even been reported in many of the popular newspapers and news magazines in the world. In fact, if I had time, I could walk you through a stack of materials that I have in my own study that's probably an inch to 2 inches thick, just full of articles about this very thing. People see Mary in the clouds. People see Mary between two buildings in the sunlight. People see Mary, you remember this, even in a grilled cheese sandwich. People say, oh, there's Mary. In fact, I heard that sandwich actually sold, believe it or not, on eBay for some $10,000. People are seeing Mary everywhere. Now, some of this is sort of silly, and we understand that, but some of it is downright, unquestionably supernatural. Bleeding statues and weeping statues, and even Mary appearing in some kind of a bodily form to people. I'm back at the study guide. Even Protestants, agnostics, atheists, and others have reportedly been visited or in some way touched by this Mary. I'm using the term Mary in quotes, by the way. Mary. All of this raises serious questions for the committed Christian believer. Is this really Mary? Could it even be Mary? And how can we tell if this is true or if it is a dangerous what? Deception from Satan. These are some of the very questions that we will seek to answer, and in answering these questions, we will answer our larger question about the resurrection and the immortality of the soul. Several years ago, I came upon this book here entitled The Thunder of Justice, The Warning, The Miracle, The Chastisement, and The Era of Peace, written by two Catholic individuals, Ted and Maureen Flynn. Now, Ted and Maureen Flynn are here claiming and documenting that Mary, that is what they believe to be Mary, has been appearing to people, as we've just suggested, all over the globe. And she has a special message of warning, a special message of chastisement for planet Earth. And it's actually quoted right here in this book entitled The Thunder of Justice. In the opening page, it says this. This is supposedly the Virgin Mary speaking. She says, "A chastisement worse than the flood is about to come upon this poor and perverted humanity. Fire will descend from heaven, and this will be the sign that the justice of God has as of now fixed the hour of His great manifestation." Fascinating. Here's Mary coming back from the dead. Here's Mary coming from heaven with a special message for us, a special message for planet Earth. And of course, the question for the committed Christian believer like myself and like many of you is this really Mary, and how can we know for sure? I mean, we really only have two options. One is that it really is Mary, and she really does have a special message for us, or number two, that it is a dangerous, subtle deception of the enemy. We shouldn't be surprised if that is the case, incidentally, because as we've already learned, Satan transforms himself not into an angel of darkness, but into an angel of what? Light. That's exactly right. We would not expect Satan to show up with red leotards and a pitchfork and a pointy tail. No, 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 no. The Bible says he would transform himself into an angel of light. And so we have a very serious question before us this evening, and that is this. Are these so-called Marian apparitions the real deal, or are they a deception brought about by the father of lies? And in answering that question, we're going to answer the larger question of how to face death unafraid and with absolute confidence. Has Mary, the mother of Jesus, been sent with a special message for planet Earth? I want to let you know right now, I believe the answer to that question is no. And here's why. At least I'll give you the answers as to why, and you can make your own determination. But I'll say this, if you're going to trust the Bible and the Bible only, I think you'll be forced to come to the same conclusion. Unfortunately for us, false prophets do not show up like this. You know, false prophet. Just dial 1-666-ANTICHRIST. That's 1-666-ANTI-CHRIST. If a false prophet showed up like this with sort of a sign or a placard hanging around his or her neck, it would be so easy to detect them. Yet as we've already seen in Matthew chapter 24, Jesus said, I don't remember if it was three or four times, take heed that no man deceives you, that no man deceives you, that no man deceives you. He said false Christs and false prophets would arise and deceive not a few knuckleheads, not a few that weren't paying attention. He said that they would arise and deceive many. That's exactly right, would deceive many. And the reason that deception is so dangerous, of course, as we've already said, that you are unaware that you're being deceived. Satan doesn't show up as, you know, some kind of a figure of darkness who openly opposes Christ, etc., etc. The Bible says that he would transform himself into an angel of light, and that his ministers would transform themselves into ministers of light rather than ministers of darkness. And that's our quotation here, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 14. And no wonder, says Paul, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. And that's why we can't just look at this thing and say, oh, it's Mary. Clearly it's true. Clearly it's from God. Clearly it's biblical. No, 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 no. We have to test this to see if it is biblical, to see if it is true, and to ask the question, is it even possible that Mary has come back from the dead? Now, in doing that, let's begin by looking at a text of Scripture that's actually not in your study guide. I want to be crystal clear about something here, and I'm going to Leviticus chapter 20. Leviticus chapter 20, that's third book of the Old Testament, Leviticus chapter 20, and I'm going to read the last verse of that chapter, Leviticus chapter 20 and verse 27. It says, "A man or a woman who has a medium or who has a familiar spirit shall surely be put to what? Death." It says, it goes on to say, "Their blood shall be upon them, they shall stone them with stones." It's a consistent teaching in the Old Testament that if somebody was a channeler or a medium or somehow communicating with the dead, that these people were not to be, you know, praised. These people were not to be looked up to for their spiritual gift. The Bible actually goes so far as to say, God speaking to Moses, Moses speaking to the children of Israel, these people should be stoned. Why so severe? Why so harsh? Why was God so insistent about the austerity and the seriousness of this punishment? The answer is this. God knew that people that were communicating with the dead were not communicating with the dead at all. In fact, they were actually communicating with the devil and his demons. In fact, I'm in Deuteronomy chapter 18. You're there in Leviticus. Just go to the next book, which is Numbers, and the next book, which is Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 18, and I'll begin reading in verse 9. Deuteronomy chapter 18 and verse 9. When you come into the land which the Lord your God is giving you, you shall not learn to follow the abominations of those nations. Verse 10. There shall not be found among you anyone who makes his son or his daughter pass through the fire, or anyone who practices witchcraft, or a soothsayer, or one who interprets omens, or a sorcerer. Verse 11. Or one who conjures spells, or a medium, or a spiritualist, or one who, listen, calls up the dead. Verse 12, for all who do these things are an abomination to the Lord, and because of these abominations, the Lord your God is driving them out from before you. You shall walk blameless before the Lord your God. Fascinating. Here, two times in the Old Testament, and other instances could be cited, God says, if there's a channeler or a medium, somebody who is do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do calling people up from the dead, God does not say, oh, sure, laud them for their spiritual, you know, keenness, laud them for their spiritual gifts, etc., etc. No. God says, those people are an abomination to me. They should be an abomination to you. They are to be stoned. Now again, we are forced to ask the question, why is God so strong here? Why is God so serious here? Why is God so seemingly austere here? It's because God knows that people that are talking to the dead are not really talking to the dead. They're talking to the devil himself, masquerading himself as a dead loved one, or etc., etc. And so this really, right at the very outset, gives us very strong pause to wonder, is it even possible that Mary has returned back and is communicating with people in the present tense? If we're going to look at the Old Testament picture of this, the idea that Mary has returned from the dead to communicate with us, now that would be significant cause for concern. Because people in the Old Testament, people in the times of the Bible times who communicated with the dead, were stoned to death because it was such a serious abomination and infraction to God. Now let's continue on here. In order to understand this question about death and immortality, it will be absolutely critical for us to recognize something, and that is this. Man is not by nature immortal. I want to say that again. Man is not by nature immortal. Now there are many people that believe that, but Bible-believing Christians should not believe that. The Bible nowhere says that man is by nature immortal. The Bible nowhere says that man is inherently immortal. The Bible says that immortality is given to us as a gift when we exercise faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Immortality is given to us as a what, everyone? A gift. That's exactly right. In fact, we've already quoted John chapter 3, verse 16. Let's quote it again. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever what? Believes in him should not perish, but have the opposite of perishing, which is what? Eternal life. So notice that eternal life or immortality comes as a result of accepting Jesus as your personal Savior. It's not something you possess inside of yourself. It's not something that you possess innately or inherently. It's a gift that God gives you. We'll come back to that point in just a moment. There are people that believe that you are naturally, innately, inherently immortal, but most of them are New Age spiritualists. New Age, what did I say, everyone? Spiritualists like this man here, Marshall Applewhite. You might remember he led 38 people, himself being the 39th, to commit the largest mass suicide in the history of the human experience here in the United States of America. 39 people, many of them intelligent people, well-educated people, ending their lives. Why? Why? I'll tell you why. Because this man had convinced them that they were immortal. Of course, the word immortal means you cannot die, and he had them convinced that when they ended their life here, they weren't really dying in the traditional sense. They were just, as he said, shedding this shell, shedding this skin, and moving on to a higher plane. And the higher plane, as you recall, that they were going to get on was they were going to get in some kind of a spacecraft, a spacemobile, and ride around through the universe behind the comet Hale-Bopp. Now, beloved, this man believed in the natural immortality of the soul, but he was wrong. And Bible-believing Christians who are going to stand on what the Bible says and not what New Agers say or what spiritualists say, they are going to have to base what they believe about death on the Bible and nothing else. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. That's exactly right. So let's go to our study guide here as we address this question of the issue of immortality. Notice right here in your study guide that there are two essential elements that sort of undergird and are the foundation for spiritualism. Spiritualism is founded upon two essential elements. The first is conscious life exists after death, what we would call natural immortality. Conscious life exists after death. That's one of the foundational cardinal elements of spiritualism. The second is the dead can communicate with the living. That's New Age spiritualism. That's Egyptian paganism. That's Babylonian paganism. That's Greek paganism. It's not biblical Christianity, as we've already seen. In the Bible, if somebody was communicating with the dead or channeling the dead or acting as a medium for the dead, they weren't lauded for their spiritual gifts and attributes. They were stoned. Now, beloved, you know I'm speaking very strong here and very powerful here, but the reason is this. There is a gross deception that is sweeping the world, and that is this idea that mankind is naturally immortal, and it's not just people like Marshall Applewhite and others who are going to fall for it. Even many Bible-believing Christians, many good people, have been lured into this ridiculous non-biblical teaching that when you die, you don't really die. Now, two cardinal elements of spiritualism. Number one, natural immortality, that is conscious life after death. And number two, the dead can communicate with the living. As we've already said, in Israel, those who communicated with the dead were what? Stoned. That's exactly right. So, where is Mary, the mother of Jesus? Does she have a special message? I believe the answer to that question is going to be easier to find when we go to man's original creation. Genesis chapter 2. Go with me to Genesis chapter 2, and I'm picking it up in verse 7. First book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. We're going to take a look at creation. In order to understand death, we're going to first understand creation. And what we're going to find is that creation is actually very easy, very simple to understand. It's 1 plus 1 mathematics. 1 plus 1 equals something else. And we'll see that right here in Genesis chapter 2. And notice with me verse 7. It says, "And the Lord God formed man," notice this carefully, "out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." Does everyone see that there? That he formed man out of the dust of the earth, and so here was this man, this form, this figure, a cadaver, if you will, but it was lifeless. It had no energy, it had no vivifying power, and so God had to breathe into this man what? The breath of life, and then notice what it says. Notice the language very, very carefully. It doesn't say that God gave man a soul. It doesn't say that man possessed a soul. It says man became a living soul. Now, I want you to think about that for just a moment. It's not as though Adam could have reached into his pocket and pulled out and said, "Oh, look what I have here. I have my soul." No. He didn't possess a soul, he didn't own a soul, he didn't have a soul as much as he was a soul. And that's directly out of your study guide and it's directly out of the Bible. Man became a living soul. Let's all say that together. Man became a living soul. If that makes sense, I want you to say amen. But what were the two elements? What were the two elements? Body plus breath equals a living soul. That is the dust of the ground plus the breath of God equals a living soul. So there it is. Body plus breath equals a living soul. 1 plus 1 equals what, everyone? Equals 2. You've got it. I'm on page 3 of your study guide. Think of a light bulb. In order for us to have a light bulb, we would have to have, or in order for us to have light, we'd have to have two elements. Number one, we'd have to have the housing, that is the physical housing of the bulb, but then we'd have to have power. What, everyone? Power. That's exactly right. And so notice this here. Here's our light, and it's shiny because both elements are there. We have power and we have a housing. But what happens if we take that light and we go and unplug the power source? What happens? The light goes out. Now, beloved, where does the light go when the light bulb, or pardon me, when the power source is pulled out? Where does the light go? Well, let me tell you where it doesn't go. It does not go to light heaven. Did you catch that? It doesn't go to light heaven. It ceases to exist. So here, let's look at it again. Here we have the light because both elements are there. You have the housing. That would be just like Adam. He was there, you know, sort of in the garden, not yet alive, just a form, a piece of dirt, a piece of dust. And then God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and vroom, Adam comes to life. Okay? Both elements are there, just like the light bulb and the power. Both are there. But if we take the power out, if we unplug it, what's our essential? Body plus breath equals a living soul. Again, let's say that together. Body plus breath equals a living soul. Here's another way of communicating it. Imagine that I have here a box. A what, everyone? A box. And this box is made of two components. It's made of boards and nails. Boards and nails. And so I've put my box here all together, and we're looking at my box. We're admiring my fine workmanship. We're admiring my box. But then I want you to imagine that I take my hammer and I and I put the boards over here, and I put the nails over here. Okay, two components, right? The boards and the nails. So boards and nails. Let me ask you this question. Where did the box go? Where did the box go? That's exactly right. It ceased to exist. What I want you to notice is that the box did not go to box heaven. It simply ceased to exist. And that's exactly what we're going to discover here in our study guide and in the Bible. Death is simply creation, let's say that together, in reverse. Death is creation in reverse. Think about it. If body plus breath equals life, then body minus breath would equal what? Death. That's exactly right. So death is simply creation in reverse. If you take the body, the form that God has given us, this physical form that's here, if God takes his breath back, then of course I would die. In fact, let me show you that. We're in the book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes in the Old Testament. You open your Bible right to the middle. You're probably in Psalms. Go forward to Proverbs. And then we land in Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. And notice with me here. Let's see if we can discover it. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. And I am in verse 7. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7. It says, then the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. So the dust goes to the earth, as we say, ashes to ashes, and what? Dust to dust. And notice it says here, the spirit returns to God who gave it. Now you might be saying, oh, but David, that says the spirit. The word breath and spirit in the Old Testament are translated from the word ruach, and it's the same word, breath and spirit. In the New Testament, it's from pneuma. That's the spirit, and that's the breath. We have pneumatic tires. We have pneumatic drills. It just means breath or spirit. And so very simple here, it says that a man's body returns to the dust, and the breath of the spirit returns to God who gave it. So life is body plus breath equals a living soul. And death is body minus breath equals death, or the cessation of life. You're getting it. It's very, very simple as a matter of fact. Now, let's address this whole question of immortality, because there's going to be someone who hears these tapes or who sees these DVDs or who's sitting in our audience tonight who's just bound to believe that you are naturally immortal. Notice this, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 16. It's speaking of God. It says, God alone, who alone has what, everyone? Immortality, dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen nor can see. Now, according to that verse, who alone has immortality? That's exactly right, God. God has immortality innately, God has immortality inherently, and God gives us immortality as a gift when we accept the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. In fact, if you'd like, you can write down there 1 John chapter 2, or is it chapter 3, verse 15? Let's see if I can find it quickly. If you'd like to meet me there, you're welcome to do that. 1 John chapter 3 or 2, I'll find it here in 2 seconds. 1 John, let's see, after Peter, 1 John chapter 3, verse 15 should be, yep, there it is, 1 John chapter 3, verse 15, it says, whoever, listen carefully, whoever hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. No murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Okay, so if the murderer doesn't have eternal life, that means he doesn't have what? Immortality. That's exactly right. Of course, the unrepentant murderer does not get eternal life. The only one who gets eternal life are those who put their faith in Jesus Christ. As we've already quoted John chapter 3, verse 16 several times, only those who put their faith in Jesus receive everlasting life, because God gives them immortality. God gives them what, everyone? Immortality. That's right. Now, let's just look at that word immortality so we can better understand it. The word mortal means subject to death. Means what, everyone? Subject to death. The word immortal means the opposite, not subject to death. Question, is man subject to death? Absolutely. So is he mortal or immortal? That's right. He's mortal. God alone has what? immortality. It's interesting to note, by the way, that the Bible never uses the terms immortal soul or immortality of the soul. You won't find those terms anywhere in the Bible. Immortal soul or immortality of the soul. In fact, as we're going to discover perhaps today and perhaps in a future lesson, that this whole idea of the immortality of the soul is actually a Greek idea. Okay, it was called Platonic dualism, or sometimes referred to as anthropological dualism. It is not a biblical idea. The Bible writers saw man as a holistic entity, not in this dual fashion that the Greeks believed that man had a physical component that would die, but then he had an invisible component that was eternal and imperishable and thus immortal. Okay, we're going to discover that's a pagan concept, not a biblical concept. Okay. Now look at Psalm 115, verse 17. Psalm 115, verse 17, right there in your study guide it says, "The dead do not praise the Lord, nor any who go down into what? Into silence." That's right. Now I want you to notice that. The dead don't praise the Lord. Very simple. The dead do not give praise to God. Now, beloved, what many people teach is that the moment you die, you are whisked away into heaven. You are whisked away into heavenly places. And of course, if we're in the presence of God, I'm going to be praising Him. Aren't you going to be praising Him? Sure, of course. But notice what it says. The dead do not, what? Praise the Lord, nor any who go down to silence. In fact, there are several passages right there in your study guide. Let's look up just a few of them very quickly. Let's see if your fingers are as dexterous as mine. I'm in Psalm 146. You're there in Psalm 117, so it should be easy to find. Psalm 146, and I'm reading verse 5. Listen carefully. Psalm 146, verse 5. Actually, we'll pick it up in verse 3. "Do not put your trust in princes, nor in a son of man in whom there is no help." Verse 4, "His spirit departs, he returns to his earth, in that very day his thoughts perish." That's verses 3 and 4. So notice, don't put your trust in princes. In a modern day translation, it would probably say something like, don't put your trust in politicians, don't put your trust in presidents. Amen? Absolutely. Why? Why? Because they're going to die. Put your trust in God who cannot die. Or better yet, put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ who did die, but through His power overcame this great enemy called death at the resurrection. Notice he says, don't put your trust in princes because they die, their dust returns to the earth, and their breath is gone. Very simple. In that very day, it says their thoughts perish. Their plans perish. You're there in Ecclesiastes. Remember, that's easy to find. Psalms, and then you go to Proverbs, and then you go to Ecclesiastes. Notice with me chapter 9. Ecclesiastes chapter 9. We've already been in chapter 12, so you should be able to find it pretty easily. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, and I'm looking at verse 5. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 5. "For the living know that they will what? Die, but the dead know," what's the next word? "Nothing." Plain as the noonday sun. "The dead know nothing, for the memory of them is forgotten, neither have they any more reward of anything that is done under the sun." You can drop down to verse 6. "Also their love, their hatred, their envy have now perished. Nevermore will they have any share in anything that is done under the sun." And finally, verse 10 of Ecclesiastes 9. "Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might." Why? "For there is no work or device or knowledge or wisdom in the grave where you are going." Now, beloved, it's very simple. In the day you die, your emotions perish. Your love perishes. Your hate perishes. Your envy perishes. In the day you die, your thoughts perish. In the day you die, your plans perish. In the day that you die, conscious existence comes to an end. You say, what? I've never heard such a radical idea. Beloved, that's what the Bible is teaching. The moment that you die, conscious existence comes to a what, everyone? To an end. In fact, that's right there in your study guide. They all speak, all of these texts speak of death as the end of conscious existence. It's like a sleep. It's like a what word did I say, everyone? Like a sleep. Now remember, what was that word I told you at the beginning of the message to hang on a hook in your mind? What was that word, everyone? That's right. It was the word sleep. Open your Bible with me to John chapter 11, and we're going to find that this is precisely how Jesus referred to the question of death. He referred to it as a sleep. I'm in John chapter 11. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, New Testament, fourth book of the New Testament, John chapter 11. Picking it up in verse 1. It says, "Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, in the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore the sister sent to him, saying, 'Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick.'" Verse 4, Jesus says, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified through it." Verse 5, "Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed in that same place 2 more days. Verse 7, "Then he said, 'Let us go to Judea again.'" The disciples protest. Say, "Lord, the last time we went to Judea, they tried to stone you." But Jesus says something very interesting. He says in verse 11, "Our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I'm going to go wake him up." 2 days earlier, Jesus had received the message, "Your friend Lazarus is sick." Now Jesus says, "Lazarus is asleep, I'm going to go wake him up." And the disciples said, "Oh no, Jesus, maybe we need to explain something to you about the principles of health. Maybe we need to explain something to you about the principles of how you get better and how you feel, you know, better after you've been sick for a time. You've got to let him sleep." Notice that in verse 12. The disciples said, "Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get better. If he sleeps, he'll do well." Verse 13, "However, Jesus spoke of his" what, everyone? You've got it. Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought that he had been speaking of taking a rest in sleep. Verse 14, "Then Jesus said to them plainly," say it with me, "Lazarus is dead." Now, what did Jesus first call this? He said, "Our friend Lazarus," what? "Sleeps." When the disciples didn't get it, Jesus reluctantly used the term death. Lazarus is dead. So Jesus shows up there, and of course he's greeted by Martha and he's greeted by Mary. We'll pick it up in verse 21. John chapter 11, verse 21. "Now Martha said to Jesus, 'Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, whatever you ask of God, God will give it to you.' Jesus said to her, 'Hey, listen, sister, your brother will rise again.'" Now Jesus is thinking in his mind in about 20 minutes. But I want you to notice Martha's response. Martha said to him, verse 24, "I know that he will rise again in the" what? What's that word, everyone? "Resurrection." When? At the last day. We might legitimately ask the question, what did Martha believe about death? What did Martha believe about death? Did she believe that Lazarus was up in glory? Did she believe that, as so many modern day preachers teach, did she believe that Lazarus was up just chilling with Gabriel on streets of gold in the New Jerusalem? She didn't believe that for a moment. Jesus said, "Your brother's going to rise again." And she said, "I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Powerful. Jesus says to her, here it is in verse 25, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet he will live." Powerful. Let's all jump all the way down to verse 38. Jesus then again groaning within himself, he came to the tomb. It was a cave and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said, "Take away the stone." And Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said, "Lord, I don't think that's such a good idea. He's going to stink. He's been in there for 4 days. Then verse 40, Jesus said to her, "Did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God?" Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and he said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I know you always hear me. But because of the people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me." Now when he said these things, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth!" Lazarus, not come down, not come up, Lazarus come. What's that word, everyone? Lazarus come forth. And look at verse 44. "And he who had died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said, 'Loose him and let him go.'" There's Jesus at the tomb. He doesn't say, "Lazarus, come down." Because Jesus knew what Martha knew. Lazarus wasn't in heaven. He was in the grave. What was he doing in the grave? Jesus said he was sleeping. Jesus said he was what, everyone? He was sleeping. And so he doesn't say, "Lazarus, come down." I mean, wouldn't that have been a story? Can you imagine Lazarus up there in heaven, one arm around Gabriel, one arm around another angel, just praising the Lord Jesus to be in glory, you know, and he hears this voice. What? What? And he looks down, he looks over a cloud there, and sure enough, it's Jesus saying, "Lazarus, come down." I can imagine Lazarus saying, No. "I've been there. I don't want to go back to that dark old world." Jesus didn't say, "Lazarus, come down," because Jesus knew Lazarus wasn't in heaven. Martha didn't believe that. Jesus didn't believe that. He said, Lazarus, come forth. Why? Because he was in that grave. As we've already seen, man is not naturally immortal. As we've already seen, in the day you die, you don't praise the Lord. In the day that you die, your thoughts perish. In the day that you die, your emotions perish. In the day that you die, your plans perish. Why? What's happening? Jesus equated it to a sleep. Now, I'm not one of these people that fall asleep in church or that fell asleep in school, but there are people like that. And I can remember on one occasion I did fall asleep in school. And it was one of those things, you might have had a similar experience, where I just put my head down for a moment. And, you know, I was just so tired, and I think it was maybe chemistry class or something, and I just, and it felt like it was about 15 seconds. I just, boom. And when I woke up, I was in social studies class. An hour and a half had passed, and it had seemed like just a moment. I'm a very deep sleeper. In fact, every night I go to sleep, and the last thing I say to my wife is, sweetheart, I love you very much, and the next thing I know is my alarm clock. That's how I am. I'm just a very deep sleeper. In fact, sometimes my wife will say, oh, sweetie, did you hear the thunder and the lightning, and or did you hear the thunder and see the lightning, and did you hear the heavy rains, and did you hear the boys crying at night? And I'll say, nope. When I go to sleep, I go to sleep. For me, it seems like a moment, it seems like a second, and I go to sleep, and the very next thing is I wake up. That's how death is. Beloved, death is like a sleep. It's a suspended state of consciousness. It's a suspended state of awareness, so that if, heaven forbid, tonight as I'm driving home from the meeting, if I'm driving home and a car were to hit me and I were to die, the very next thought that I would have, the very next thought that would be in my mind is the resurrection and the second coming of Jesus. And guess what? That would be true for Adam. That would be true for Abraham. That would be true for Isaac and Jacob. Because while you're in that grave, you have no conscious, cognizant awareness of time. Lazarus, all he knew is that he was there on the deathbed getting sicker and sicker and sicker. And the next thing he knows, dude, he's coming out of a tomb wrapped with all these funny clothes. The grave clothes. Beloved, that is God's plan. The Bible calls death a sleep. Let's say that together. The Bible calls death a what, everyone? You've got it, a sleep. You see, beloved, the dead sleep the sleep of death until the resurrection. Go with me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians. We've already been here, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We read this at the outset when we looked at the first few verses there, when the Apostle Paul says, if Christ isn't risen, your faith is futile. But what I want you to do now is go to the last part of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I'm picking it up in verse 50. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all, what's that word? Sleep, you've got it. But we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, when, according to this verse, at the last trump. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and when this mortal has put on immortality, then, and not a moment before, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Did you see it there, everyone? Remember that word I told you to hang on a hook in your mind? It was the word sleep. And that's what the Apostle Paul says here. He says, not everyone is going to sleep, but we'll all be changed. In other words, some people are going to be alive when Jesus returns. Some people like Enoch of old and like Elijah, who was taken to heaven in a fiery chariot, are not going to die. They'll be translated directly to heaven without seeing death. And oh Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching. I want to be in that number, don't you? I would just assume not die as die. That's what Paul says. We're not all going to sleep, but we will all be changed. And did you hear the language? He says at that time, at the last trump, when everyone? At the last trump, this mortal will put on what, everyone? Immortality. You've got it. Beloved, we get immortality as a gift. As a what? As a gift. When? At the resurrection. You've got it. Powerful. So this sleeping the sleep of death is biblical. In fact, there are so many texts. The Bible actually refers to death as a sleep more than 70 times. More than 70 times the Bible refers to death as a sleep. And of course, that's Jesus knew that. You have all kinds of Old Testament passages like this. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 12. And when your days be fulfilled, you shall sleep with your fathers. sleep with you. It doesn't mean you'll take a nap with your dad. It doesn't mean you'll take a nap with your grandpa. What it means is you're going to die. Over 70 times the Bible refers to death as a sleep. 70 times. It's like God is trying to get our attention. He's trying to say, it's like a sleep, it's like a sleep. It's like a sleep, it's like a sleep. It's like a sleep, it's like a sleep. Well, what's it like when you sleep? When you sleep, you go to sleep, and the very next thing you know is you wake up. Right? The very next thing you know is, whoop, I'm awake, and that's how the resurrection will be. Now, I want to be sensitive here because I know there are some who have believed that, you know, Uncle Betty or Aunt Judy or some dear loved one has been in heaven. I want to speak to you as a pastor. I want to speak to you as a friend. Beloved, that's not biblical. The great truth of the Scriptures, the great truth of the New Testament is that when you die, you sleep the sleep of death and you await the resurrection. And because Christ was raised, we can be raised. In fact, nowhere is this clearer than in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Go there with me. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, unmistakable language. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, the Apostle Paul writing to the church at Corinth. Did I say Thessalonians? Should be 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and I'm reading in verse 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. Paul says, "But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which have fallen asleep." Notice that. He says, I don't want you to be confused about those who have fallen asleep. Now, he's clearly not talking about those who have taken a rest and nap, because it says in verse 4, the rest of verse 13, it says, "Lest you sorrow not, even as others who have no hope." You know, if I go to take a nap, my wife doesn't start crying. If I go to take a nap, my wife isn't sad. What he's saying here is, I don't want you to be ignorant concerning those who have fallen asleep, like others who don't have the hope of the resurrection, how they sorrow. Sure, we sorrow when someone dies, but we don't sorrow like they sorrow. Verse 14, "For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again," and how many of us believe that tonight? Amen. "Even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus." And someone says, oh, look, he's bringing him back with him. No, 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 no. Look at verse 15. The context makes it abundantly clear. "For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are what? Asleep." See, that's what the people in Thessalonica thought. They thought, oh, no, this person died. Oh, no, this person died. Oh, no, this person died. God has forgotten about them, and the Redeemer is going to come, and they'll be lost forever. No, Paul was saying, I don't want you to be ignorant concerning those that have fallen asleep, because if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and we all believe that, amen, we believe that Jesus will come, and he will raise the dead. He'll what, everyone? Raise the dead. Powerful. And then it goes on to say, "We who are alive and remain will by no means precede those who are asleep." Verse 16, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God." That's the third time we've seen that today. The trumpet of God, the trumpet of God, the trumpet of God. And notice this, "And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up," what's that word? "Together with them." Who's them? "Those that were dead that have been raised in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord." And look at verse 18. Verse 18 is powerful. It says, "Therefore." And remember, beloved, when you see the word "therefore," ask yourself what? What's that "therefore"? "Therefore, comfort one another with these words." What words? With the words that there's the hope of the resurrection because we're trusting in the resurrected Christ. Notice he doesn't say, comfort one another with the words that they're already in glory. Comfort one another with the words that they're already in heaven hanging out with Gabriel and the other angels. He doesn't say that at all. What he says is, comfort one another with the words that even though they've died, even though they're in the grave, they will not remain there because the resurrected Christ has the keys to death. He has the keys to Hades, and he can awake them by his grace and mighty power. If you believe that, say amen. Whoo, don't get me stirred up here. The word "spirit," we're going to skip right over that. We've already talked about that. James chapter 2, verse 26. Notice James says it as plain as can be. "For as the body without the spirit," that is the breath, "is dead, so faith without works is dead." The body minus the spirit is dead. Death is a sleep. Death is a what, everyone? Death is like a sleep. Well, where did this idea of the immortality of the soul come from anyway? Someone says, well, where did that come from? I've always believed that. Aha! Remember what the serpent said there to the woman? He said, "In the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt not surely die." God had said four words. In the day that you eat of it, thou shalt surely die. And the devil inserted a word, didn't he? He said, "You will not surely die." And that's what many people believe today. They believe that when you die, you don't really die. You only sort of die, kind of die, ish. Beloved, God was telling the truth. Did Adam die? Sure he did. Did Eve die? Sure she did. God had said, thou shalt surely die. Four words. It was the devil who said, thou shalt not surely die. And that's what all of the pagans believed. That's what the Babylonians believed. That's what the Greeks believed. That's what New Agers believe, that when you die, you don't really die. You only kind of die. And that's why they believed you could communicate with the what? Dead. You see, it's all coming full circle now, isn't it? This is not just a little theoretical truth. This is a powerful biblical truth, because as we began this presentation, we asked the question, is Mary, has she been sent with a special message for planet Earth? The answer, beloved, is absolutely not. Where, according to the Bible, is Mary? She's in the grave, awaiting the what, everyone? The resurrection. You got it. What's the big deal, you might say, beloved? It saves us from deception. Saves us from what? Deception. And not only that, it's a much better plan. It's a much better plan. God's plan is so much better. Why? Because we all get to go to heaven together. When? At the resurrection. Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, you might be also. Notice Jesus didn't say, Peter, I'll see you in a few years when you're crucified upside down, and Bartholomew, I'll see you in a few years, and Thomas, I'll see you in a few years when this happens, and I'll see you all at different times. No, he knew that he was going to see all of his disciples at the same time when he came back to call them from the graves. Beloved, I don't want to be one of those that dies. I'd rather be one of those that is translated without seeing death. But the reality is that in a crowd this size, some of us likely are going to die before Jesus returns. But you have the hope that Jesus died and was raised, and you can be raised because he was raised. He has the keys to death. He has the keys to Hades. This saves us from pagan ideas. This saves us from non-biblical ideas. And most of all, it gives us a very powerful, very beautiful, very accurate world view. It gives us a biblical picture of death. You can face death with absolute confidence and unafraid. How many of you tonight want to accept this Bible truth and accept the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus as your personal hope, your personal confidence? Amen. Amen. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we are thrilled as we see the biblical picture. Not some man-made, manufactured picture, but the biblical picture. Give us confidence, resolute confidence in the resurrected Christ. Father, help us not to imbibe paganism or New Ageism. Help us, Father, to imbibe the Bible. Jesus said death was asleep. Paul said death was asleep. The whole Bible says death is like a sleep, and Jesus calls to raise his sleeping children from the dusty graves. And he has every right to do it because he himself was in the grave and was raised. As we began Revelation 1:18, I am he who was dead, but I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of Hades. Oh Father, we put our trust in him who has the keys of death and of Hades, Jesus Christ. Let everyone say, Amen.